In the US, we are taught at an early age that Thomas Edison was probably the greatest inventor who ever lived. There is no argument that he created some of the most spectacular technology the world has ever seen. He certainly did hold more than 1,000 patents. However, it appears that he may have gone to any length to claim credit for inventions of other people's work and creativity. Edison gets credit for the fluoroscope. This was a device which first made X-rays possible and also added to Edison's growing wealth. The problem is that the actual inventor of a device to see the bones of a human was a German scientist named William Röntgen, who took an X-ray of his wife's hand several years prior to Edison's fluoroscope. Edison was more than happy not to correct the error. Another concept Edison is given credit for is creating devices for recording speech and other forms of sound. A French printer and bookseller named Edward Leon Scott de Martinville created his phonautograph more than 15 years before Edison's 1877 invention of the phonograph. Again, Thomas Edison made no mention of Martinville when marketing his own device. Many people regard Edison as the father of motion pictures. However, there's a fairly solid argument that Louis Le Prince created a working motion picture before Edison, but when traveling to America to patent it, he got on a train and nobody saw him again. His son continued with the patent request and eventually testified against Edison, but someone shot him, so Edison got the lucrative patent. There's no doubt, however, that Edison was a great businessman and knew how to manipulate the press in his favor. You probably heard about the famous rivalry between Nikola Tesla and Thomas Edison, where Edison electrocuted cats, dogs, and even an elephant to make Tesla's AC/DC technology seem more dangerous than his own direct current technology. What most people are not aware of, however, is that Edison was very interested in the afterlife, entranced with it, in fact, and in his eyes, life after death was not the way perhaps many envision it. His theory was that there was basically a set amount of life in the universe, and that it could not be created or destroyed, much like the conservation of energy or mass law in thermodynamics. This life, he surmised, came in the form of myriads of infinitesimal entities, each a separate consciousness, which acted much like atoms do with matter, forming the smallest building blocks of life as we know it. According to him, the individual consciousnesses in each person were made up of unique patterns of these tiny entities, which grouped together in swarms within the brain to form our soul. He believed that death came when these tiny entities disagreed, and that they could go on into existence beyond the physical body. In Edison's own words, and I quote, "I believe that life, like matter, is indestructible. There has always been a certain amount of life in this world, and there will always be the same amount. You cannot create life, you cannot destroy life, you cannot multiply life. I believe our bodies are composed of myriads and myriads of entities, each in itself a unit of life, which band together to build a man. In our bodies, these entities constantly rebuild our tissues to replace those which are constantly wearing out. They watch after functions of the various organs, just as the engineers in a powerhouse see that the machinery is kept in perfect order. Once conditions in the body become unsatisfactory in the body, either through a fatal sickness, fatal accident, or old age, the entities simply depart from the body and leave little more than an empty structure behind. Being diligent workers, they naturally seek something else to do. They either enter into the body of another man or even start to work on some other form of life. At any rate, there's a fixed amount of these, and it is the same entities that have served over and over again. They fight out their differences, and then the stronger group takes charge. If the minority is willing to be disciplined and to conform, there is harmony. But minorities sometimes say, 'To hell with this place, let's get out of it.' They refuse to do their appointed work in the man's body. He sickens and dies. And they are all free to seek out new experiences somewhere else. When we die, these swarms of units, like a swarm of bees, so to speak, betake themselves elsewhere and go on to functioning in some other form or environment. There are many indications that we human beings act as a community rather than as units. That is why I believe that each of us comprises millions upon millions of entities, and that our body and our mind represent the vote or voice, whichever you wish to call it, of our entities. The entities live forever. Death is simply the departure of the entities from our body. If the units of life which compose an individual's memory hold together after death, is it not within range of possibility, to say the least, that these memory swarms could retain the powers they formerly possessed and thus retain what we call the individual's personality after dissolution of the body? I'm hopeful that by providing the right kind of instrument to be operated by this personality, we can receive intelligent messages from it in its changed habitation or environment. End quote. Edison surmised that if these particles of consciousness could be arranged back into their prior harmony, then that dead person's consciousness would be essentially resurrected. It was his guess that some sort of photographic plate could be used to record the precise layout of these entities and serve as a sort of snapshot to the personality that had passed on, allowing them to be put back together again. Edison apparently spent a lot of effort trying to prove that these theoretical particles existed, gathering a team of scientists to test out a machine that could detect them, and trying to craft a device that could be used to communicate with personalities that had passed from the world of the living. He would, in October of 1920, give a rather spectacular announcement to the media, saying that he had been working on an apparatus that would be able to contact the dead, which would go on to be called the spirit phone. It is unknown just how far along Edison was on an actual device to talk to spirits, but Nikola Tesla was also developing a similar device at the same time. Both men were racing to create something that picked up on the frequencies of discarnate spirits, what today is called EVP, or electronic voice phenomenon. Nikola Tesla thought that the universe was composed of an infinite variety of sound and electromagnetic waves, and that if you could zero in on the right ones, you could hear the voices of the departed. My name is Robert Sepehr. I'm an anthropologist. You can find my published work on Amazon. Please don't forget to subscribe, hit like, share, and leave your thoughts in the comment section. Thank you for listening, and I hope to see you again soon.